Today I'm taking you on an excursion into the Heubach Valley. It is the side valley of the Kinzig River in the central Black Forest. Here, the Karlsruhe Institute of Technology and the University of Stuttgart have been operating the Black Forest Observatory, or BFO for short, since 1972. But what is being observed here? Hello and welcome. Among other things, seismic signals and the Earth's gravitational field are observed here at the BFO. For this purpose, various seismometers and gravimeters are operated in the decommissioned mining tunnel. That brings us to today's topic, seismometry. You will learn how sensitive seismometers work and what boundary conditions are important for their operation. You will learn which forces act on the instruments and will be able to evaluate them with regard to the mode of operation and the structure of the seismometers. One expert in the field of seismometry is the seismologist Thomas Forbriger. Together with his colleagues, he ensures the high quality of the data and a continuous operation of the measurement instruments here at BFO. With the records, long wave surface waves or the free oscillations of the Earth can be researched. Hi Thomas.
Welcome Andreas.
The seismometers here are located 170 meters under the earth and around 700 meters from the entrance of the tunnel. Why all this effort?
We operate instruments that measure ground motion, gravitational acceleration and deformation, and the seismometers need to be able to record extremely weak signals from the depths of the earth's interior. That is why we are far away from sources of human interference that would drown out these signals. Furthermore, it's important that all these instruments are shielded from atmospheric influences. Above all, it is important to shield them from temperature changes, changes in air pressure, and forces that act directly on the Earth's surface.
Before we enter the tunnel, let's look around the laboratory building to see how seismometers actually work.
Fine, let's go.
When we imagine an earthquake, the entire Earth moves along with the shocks. So the question is, which reference point can be used to make measurements?
In seismometers, we use the inertia of mass. That means we use freely hanging inertial masses as a reference point. I have here a horizontal seismometer and a model of its working principle. And here is a vertical seismometer and a model of its working principle. These are a great illustration of how the instruments work. Hung here is an inertial mass. It needs to be supported against gravitational acceleration, otherwise it would simply fall to the ground. And if we now imagine that a seismic wave was to arrive and the ground moves up together with the housing, the mass would remain at rest briefly due to its inertia. Let me simulate that right now. As you can see, the mass remains at rest briefly while the housing moves upwards. And this difference in movement allows us to measure this movement. This functions much the same with the horizontal seismometer. When I hold the device, it is also supported against gravitational acceleration, but is able to move horizontally. When the housing moves horizontally, the mass remains briefly at rest due to its inertia and is displaced relative to the housing. But it also does that when I tilt the housing, because gravitational acceleration then causes the mass to be displaced. And that is the dilemma in seismology. We cannot differentiate between the effects of gravitational acceleration and inertial acceleration. That is the principle of equivalence between inertial and gravitational mass in physics. Specifically, this means that horizontal seismometers and inclinometers are physically identical. And in the same vein, vertical seismometers and gravimeters are identical from a physical perspective.
So much for the principle. But how is this applied in a modern seismometer?
Let's once again look at the model of the working principle of the vertical seismometer. The mass is hung on a pendulum, supported by a suspension spring and attached in an articulated fashion to a joint that suppresses 5 of the 6 degrees of freedom. When we move this seismometer, we see that it is relatively insensitive. I need to make a strong motion in order to cause displacement. This is due to the high restoring forces which occur here mechanically when the pendulum is displaced. In order to build a sensitive seismometer, I need to reduce these restoring forces. This means that I have to aestheticize the seismometer. For sensitive measurement devices, this is achieved via a suitable geometry of the pendulum and the hanging. However, with highly sensitive aestheticized seismometers, we do not measure the displacement of the mass relative to the housing, but instead utilize negative force feedback to keep the mass in its position in the housing. We then directly measure the force that is necessary to do so.
But this means that this high sensitivity of the instruments also makes them susceptible to undesirable forces.
That is correct. Changes in air pressure, for example, lead to a change in the buoyant force on the hanging mass, and temperature changes would lead to changes in the elastic modulus of the suspension spring. That is why we need to position these highly sensitive devices in the tunnel, where they are shielded from changes in temperature and air pressure.
To provide shielding, there is a pressure lock in the tunnel, and the instruments are located behind it. These instruments and the layout of the tunnel are indicated on the tunnel map. Thomas, which instruments are located in the tunnel?
If we look at the tunnel map, located here at the front is the lab building where we currently are standing. And shown here is the part of the former mine that we use for the observatory. The two pressure locks are located at these two spots. And there's a small selection of the instruments which we operate there. Located here is our superconducting gravimeter. Here in the back we have three inval wire extensiometers, a water level device. And located in this chamber are our broadband seismometers, which we use to record signals of approximately 0.3 millihertz. These are the free oscillation of the solid Earth, up to short period body waves in the range of 50 Hz. And if we enter the tunnel, we can already see a broadband seismometer in its natural habitat, here in the front of the pressure lock.
Right, let's go have a look at it in the tunnel.
Yes, Andreas, we are now in the tunnel at one of our test plinths. Two broadband seismometers have been set up here for an experiment. And to ensure that the seismometers move along precisely with the Earth, it is very important that both the seismometers on the plinth as well as the plinth itself are firmly coupled to the natural rock face, that means cast in it. We are now in the northern branch of the Treberg granite mass. This granite is a highly competent rock mass and very resistant to disrupting forces which directly affect the Earth's surface, which is why it is significantly better suited to our purposes than, for example, the sediments in the Rheingraben. And the reason we do not see the seismometers themselves here is due to the fact that they are once again meticulously shielded from disruptive external influences here. In this case, this seismometer is positioned on a gabbro rock that is warp resistant and then covered with a stainless steel container which is pressure tight and screwed onto this gabbro rock in order to protect the seismometer itself from changes in air pressure. Also under this cover is wool for thermal insulation, which again is also wound around the outside of the container, and the outermost layer is this reflective film which protects the seismometer against radiative heat transfer with the surroundings. What we can see here is the ground motion that is recorded by the seismometer. It consists of three components: upwards and downwards movement, movement to the north and south, and movement to the east and west. And the signal that currently dominates is of seismic waves, which we call ocean microseismicity. This means that these waves are stimulated on the ocean floor via pressure fluctuations, resulting from wave movements in the Atlantic, and can be observed over the entire continent. With the seismometer, we can also clearly demonstrate how sensitive these modern broadband seismometers are. The seismometer is located on a firm concrete plinth that is poured in a compact fashion. For us, it is practically non-deformable. But when I stand on top of the plinth, it is in fact depressed or dented, much like a sofa in our living room, on which a depression forms when we sit on it. For us, it is imperceptible, but it causes the seismometer to tilt, and this tilting movement causes the gravitational acceleration to displace the mass. Hence, this experiment demonstrates the equivalence between inertial and gravitational mass. I will now stand slightly to the north of the seismometer, and these two horizontal components should now react to this inclination.
Here, we clearly see how the seismometer promptly reacts. both on the north-south as well as the east-west component. You can come down now, Thomas. And we now immediately see how the seismometer tilts back into place, returning to its original equilibrium state. These instruments are located in front of the pressure lock. Other instruments are behind it. Thomas, for which type of measurements are these precautions particularly important?
We need the shielding from the rock and pressure lock for long period measurements. For example, for observing the Earth's free oscillation with periods lasting up to 1 hour. This is because the slower the ground motions are, the smaller the inertial accelerations, while all the disrupting forces retain their magnitude. For example, the pressure lock reduces all air pressure fluctuations, which take place more rapidly than with a 1.5 day period.
What this means is shielding plus good coupling plus sensitive seismometers result in a good measurement. We have now seen why seismometers are operated so deep below the Earth's surface. Thomas, what will you be investigating next?
We want to better understand the instrument noise of our superconducting gravimeter. At frequencies above 1 mHz, we presume thermal noise, much like Brownian motion.
All right, so all the best and thank you.
See you again next time. Goodbye.
The BFO is a prime example for the operation of highly sensitive measurement instruments. It is part of the global and Germany-wide measurement network for earthquake monitoring. Internationally, it is recognized for its particularly high detection sensitivity, which is all thanks to the time and effort that went into shielding the instruments here. Let me summarize the findings of our visit to the BFO. Sensitive seismometer measurements depend on the instrument itself, how it is coupled, and its shielding. Firstly, the seismometer achieves its high sensitivity via small restoring forces. This is ensured via the principle of aestheticization and negative force feedback. In this case, the instrument measures the force necessary to move the inertial mass along with the housing. Secondly, a good coupling means a firm connection with the solid rock. This ensures that the ground motion reaches the seismometer directly. And thirdly, shielding. Because the instruments are highly sensitive, the influence of undesirable signals need to be reduced. For long period measurements, these primarily include pressure differences and temperature variations. Here at the BFO, right at the back of the tunnel behind the pressure lock, they exert almost no influence. Altogether, this accounts for the extraordinary quality of the measurements made here at the BFO.